everyone. Welcome back to today's podcast. We are back. You guys know I've been sick since like May-ish, but I am back with a guest, with my friend Maiden. We're very excited to talk to you guys today. But before we jump into it, check out behind me. This is sponsored by High Priestess, which you guys know is the only company that I actually work with because I actually know the owner and she's chill and it's amazing. So I am drinking a tea from them today. This is the Viking tea. And this tea is has ingredients of organic peppermint, organic bilberry leaf, and organic bilberries. What's a bilberry, Maiden?
I have never heard of a bilberry before.
I have no idea what a bilberry is, but it sounds amazing. So let's go ahead and take a swig of the tea. Okay, so you guys know my favorite teas are like earthy teas. Other than the peppermint, which is not my favorite, it's actually super bomb and I highly recommend. So if you guys want to check it out, High Priestess, all the links are down below and they are an amazing company. Like I said, I do know the owner. She's really, really cool. And it's a, I'm sorry, I totally forgot. I also have a candle from them. And Maiden, I'm going to show you in your Discord chat right now, like how cool this candle looks. Please tell everybody how amazing it looks. I should have sent it to you before we started recording, but I didn't. Hold on, please wait. It's coming. Please wait, it is showing up. But it is a Nordic Winter's Eve candle. It's with mulled wine. It's so good. And it has like crystals in it and like this blue wax. It's beautiful. Ooh. Do you see it? Isn't it cute?
Yeah. Textured.
Yes, it's so good. Girl, I can't even tell you how good it smells too. It's right like right where, you know how like certain things you smell and you're like, that is for me. That was made for me.
Yes. Oh, I love that for you.
All their candles. Every time she sends me a candle, I'm like, can I please order more of just the candles? Like, I just, it's perfect. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to have you tell everyone who you are. So go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hey, hi, guys. I'm Maiden Monster, longtime listener, first time podcaster. I've been watching Brittany for years, since she was doing her BDSM stuff. And then about a year ago, I reached out to start doing one-on-one calls with her, and joined her Discord. And that's just become like a huge part of my life, ever since then. And, you probably, if you've seen any lives, probably recognize my name from being on the lives and in the chat there. Yes, so. Ma'am. Yeah, that's me. I'm Maiden Monster. Sex worker, housekeeper, makeup artist, jack of all trades kind of a person. So,
which is so relatable to me, obviously. I think we connected for a multitude of reasons, but the two things I love talking to you about the most is philosophy, because we love John Vervaeke. We just love philosophy in general, exploring ideas. And then, of course, like sex work, adult work. I am totally inspired by your Twitter. I have definitely perused. And there's just like, there's so many good things there. But what I think is the best part about you is 100% your brain. Like, the way you dissect ideas and talk about things is exactly why I wanted you to be on the podcast coming back. You know what I mean? Like, we've been on this hiatus. I've been so tired. And I know that my time on the Discord has just been so lovely. I've just enjoyed being around you guys and talking to you guys and going over these ideas. So, today, I thought it'd be fun to ask you, since we're both in the same age group and have similar experiences-ish, I wanted to explore those like little niches with you, I guess, basically, is what I want to do. I know we didn't talk about it beforehand, but that is what I want to do.
Awesome.
Do you have any preferences for what you want to do?
No. Okay. I'm in our calls. Go with the flow.
Okay. So I want to – wait, say that again.
Going with the flow seems to always take us to a good place, so.
Yes, it does. So I have to ask you the question that I think I've been asking myself lately. I know we've had some discussions on the Discord, but I wanted to ask myself, like, what is my favorite part about being a sex worker? In the same way that I ask myself, what's my favorite part of existing? Like, why do I like it so much? Why do I keep coming back to it?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know for yourself what the answer might be?
I mean, there's so many things that I think for me make me love the work, not the least of which is that I can have my own schedule, pretty much form my own schedule. I work for myself. I have my own rules and my own way of doing things. I'm not really answering to anybody, you know, other than my clients, but I choose who I want to see. So I choose which clients to market to.
Mm-hmm.
But that's part of it for me. Also, getting to know people, connecting with people. I know that can be kind of like roll your eyes in the sex work bubble. There's a lot of escorts who are very much like, it's just a job, you know, that kind of thing. And it very much is, but I really, really like connecting with people and making relationships, getting to know humans. And I think when you add the element of your sexuality, you can get to know people on a whole different level that's not accessible in just regular life, you know.
Explain that, because that, I think if you're saying what I think you're saying, I want to know more about that.
Well, you know, we can explore all the sides of us that we're not allowed to expose to society, that we have to kind of keep hidden. Our society is very puritanical. There's still a huge stigma for sex, alone. And going to those kind of like more shadowy places with people is so, I love that. I love that kind of connection that kind of questing affords.
Okay.
Like,
question.
Yeah.
Do you think that the fact that it's taboo is what makes it accessible, like the intimacy accessible?
Yes.
Talk to me.
Yes.
Talk to me. I know we discuss this in Discord all the time, but like, talk to me about it, girl.
I think because it's such a big bubble popping moment to even consider sex work, especially in America, it just kind of naturally affords that different level of introspection, because you have to be able to say, yes, I'm doing this thing that has a huge stigma. Some aspects of sex work are even illegal still. And then see yourself as a person doing that thing. And it helps you kind of get to know bubbles in a way.
Yeah.
Like, because you're doing this thing that's holding this big stigma that the rest of the world might look at in a certain way, but you're doing it. So you get that, like, very lived experience. And you know the truth about that in a certain way, little t truth. And so when you're willing to cross those kind of boundaries, like, your world just kind of opens up to what you can do as far as like thinking about life, being constrained by bubbles. All that stuff just kind of like, yeah.
You know, it's okay. So obviously I think about politicians. I think about when I was like a conservative in politics, how my bubbles were being popped every time I learned like these conservatives were doing things behind closed doors that they claim they weren't doing, right? I think sex workers have like a lens possibly into the layers of how the bubbles like deceive one another and themselves.
Conservative, by the way, just saying.
Say that again. Say that again.
Most sex work clients are conservative.
I believe that.
They have the money. So,
yeah.
But they're also who are working very hard to keep it taboo. So, and stigmatized. Just an interesting little factoid, but continue.
It's always been that way though, right? Hasn't it always been that way? That's what's so fascinating about humans. I don't know why we create so many weird roadblocks for ourselves. Like, no judgment towards them. Like, I mean, I'm judging, but like, let's just gay judge for a second and just be like, okay, what makes you join a bubble in which you have to hate the thing that you actively want to do?
Yeah.
But then again, like we've discussed on the Discord, maybe it is that taboo nature that keeps the simulation, like the stimulation going. And maybe that's why they continue to ban it. Not for moral reasons, like they stick it when
yeah.
they're doing their shtick.
Taboo in order to access those different affordances. Because you have to be able to break into the taboo to be able to see it for what it is. Does that make sense?
I think so. Like, you say it again, say it one more time so my brain gets it.
You have to have the taboo so that you can cross into that realm of the taboo so that you
yes.
can access different shadowy parts of us.
Okay, wait, okay, that's ding, ding, ding. So I think that is what the dilemma is. Same thing with drugs or anything else. It's like when I talk, this is the problem I've always had. When I did my BDSM stuff, I always struggled with trying to make it sound like a big deal. Because it's better for branding if you were like, oh, I'm a like sex worker. Look, I do BDSM. It's like better for branding if I make
yeah.
it super taboo, which is so funny because it's not. It's just my everyday.
Under the stigma for my services too. Yeah. So there is that.
Well, that's the question then. Do we really want to stop ourselves from experiencing this thing by making it normal?
Right. Right. And I mean, part of me does. Part of me does, but part of me doesn't.
Same.
It's like both situations and all the different like affordances that each one would have. So if it became legalized, I could probably be much more open about certain aspects of my life and just be myself more in society. Maybe. The stigma would probably remain even if it was legalized. But if I keep but that legalization or destigmatization or whatever would also kind of hinder what we're talking about as far mm-hmm. as like the ability to enter into that world of the taboo mm-hmm. and that world kind of tells us about ourselves and like what our entering into that world. Yeah.
That shows what it tells us about ourselves. Like we're always looking for the answers outside of ourselves. Right. So yeah. In combination of being introspective about the self and then existence around us, we need these tools. So, okay, yesterday we had this really great discussion and someone kept saying like maybe they need to go on this journey to fulfill their own self. Maybe somebody has to go through the taboo, specifically the taboo journey of like sex work being dirty or BDSM being dirty or something like that in order to like pop their bubble and allow introspection to occur. But here's the dilemma. And this is why I think life is exactly the way it should be. Is that for every part of the planet in which I've already learned this lesson and don't need to learn it again, there's still somebody who needs to learn it. And as much as I would like to, like an older sister or a mother, have them avoid the pain of learning this lesson the way they have to, they also have to learn it that way.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. I relate to that so much. Oh, my God. That, yeah. You have, there's a certain, like, going through that has to be done in order to bring you out and, like, have you bloom from the midst of that going through into what we are now.
Yeah. But, yeah. Like I say, you can't just go into a freaking alleyway and shoot up heroin and be like, enlightenment. Like, that's not, you can't purposely cut off your own arm. But right. In the moment, when you're really living a moment and you think, like, this is the best idea, it's like when I watch those people who used to be former, like, Nazis or something. They're like, I can't believe I used to think like that. But that's the thing. Your existence, if you lack introspection, is almost a script in which you have these moments of how could I have done that? Well, you probably weren't actually checking in with yourself. And you probably weren't like, because I have these like borderline thoughts sometimes where I'm like, Brittany. I didn't even know I had a thought that malicious in my head. But then when they show up, it like, obviously it's my borderline, but it also offers me an opportunity to ask myself, like, is this an internal subconscious thought?
Yeah, and, like, where did that come from? Oh, let's, like, follow that pathway.
Exactly. Really.
Yeah.
And I think that and most people don't, though.
That's where value comes from. Like, because it puts us in contact with those parts of ourselves. Yes. Those ones that we're talking about. Yeah.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So I think what people do is they, like, hear it or experience a part of themselves, and then they just kind of they don't actually want to interact with it. Versus, I think, the masochist... the philosopher, which is a masochistic thing to do, to question what is the self, to question like who am I? Yes. So masochistic, yes. Bro. So sadistic. Yes. But you know what? Like how beautiful. How yes. beautiful of an that's what I'm saying. Like when I think about what people have gone through to even ask themselves a question like, who am I? It's like mm-hmm. whoever like why would that be an easy pathway? And then right. as we look at the world, let's say we just take America as an example because we're both Americans and that's easier. Like we look at sex work or BDSM or the taboo nature of things. And I've seen BDSM as a lifestyle be a lifestyle, something people do for porn and sex work, something people do because it's taboo, something people do because yeah. it's on their college campus and they have a club.
Yes.
It's like yep. even sex work is eventually going to be this thing that is going to be all of those categories.
Yeah.
If it's not already. Actually, it kind of technically is-ish, right? Because, like, mm-hmm. stripping and all those things are very in right now. So, yeah. You know, people are doing it, music videos and, like, all of these things. So maybe sex work mm-hmm. is normalized enough.
There's certain aspects of it that are certainly becoming more normalized. But there's also that, like, pushback against that normalization where it's also becoming even, in some bubbles, it's becoming even more, like, stigmatized.
I wonder if there's like, you know how they did, what's it called? What model of sex work don't we like? The Nordic, the Canadian, the
model. Yeah.
The Nordic model. Mm-hmm. Like I was thinking about those things too. Like even the legalization of sex work, I've talked to so many sex workers about this, where I even think about that. Like, so I can't decide, are we because you know me, I hate rules. So part of me is like, do we make these laws for moral reasons, for like economic reasons? It doesn't matter. But I wonder like how much we are allowing, how much we are setting up society to cater. No, that's the wrong thought. Hold on. Is the wrong, well, let me just brainstorm with you. Is the thought that we are allowing society to form around our insecurities or actually our desires? So do we create laws to limit sex work because it actually fulfills our desire or because we're limiting our relationship with sex work and our bodies?
Yeah. I mean, and that makes you kind of wonder like, okay, so what even is, like, where does society even emerge from? Because it's just kind of like an amalgamation of humans. It's probably both would be my guess.
It's got to be both, right? And if it's both, like, that's what I'm saying. So if we're having this conversation out loud, we're like brainstorming out loud. I imagine there must be people who are going to listen to this and be like, sex work is always wrong. Sex work is crazy. These women are crazy. But then other people might be hearing it and be like, bubble pop, bubble pop, bubble pop. Like, wait a second. Could I think about sex work differently, like a tool, instead of something that I'm ashamed of?
Yes. Well, and I think that also, like, brings up the point that it's, sex work is not inherently empowering. You know?
Go there, it's, girl. Go there.
It's not inherently traumatizing either. It's about how the affordances that it brings to your life and the pattern that you get into through doing it. It can be a very harrowing thing for some people's lives and something that really is maybe a more negative force in their life, or it can like really open their world up and allow them to see all these things about themselves and about other people and about the world around them. It's not inherently good or bad or affording or restricting.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
There was,
it's the
go ahead, finish the girl. Finish your thought.
Oh, it's the pattern that you get into with the way of life. So
I had this like desire as a young person. I don't know how young, but pretty young, maybe 15, 14, I don't know, where I really wanted to be people's like fairy fuck mother. Like where I wanted to like I wanted to use my body as a tool to only have ideal, this is like ideal sex work dreams, guys. Like, this is not real life, but in ideal sex work dreams, I would have the most perfect clients who genuinely wanted to be better people and needed to use my body as a tool to be introspective, to then explore themselves and to be those better versions of themselves. Like, that is why do I have that wet dream? Why do I have that dream?
Because it can be, I mean, maybe not all of your clients, but like, it can be real. Like, that's kind of where I'm at. I've been doing sex work for 10 years. So I've gone through the gamut of like having it be like maybe a more narrowing thing for me. But it was through that process of seeing it kind of like close my world that I was like, wait, I need to change something here. And then I learned how to hone my boundaries. I learned like what I wanted and how I wanted to offer the service and like my niche and where my strengths lied. And so then I was able to go from that narrowing negative pattern to like something that opened my life up. And now because of knowing my boundaries, like knowing how to get along in the sex work world, I'm able to like I said, be really picky about my clients. And I have a few relationships that are just so beautiful that I've had from my sex work. And so I still do get clients, like new clients, you never know what they're going to be like, where it's like, oh, you know, that was just, you know, work, regular thing. Or some clients like, ooh, not going to see them again.
What makes you not want to see someone again?
If they keep pushing my boundaries and keep making me have to like set the rules straight, and then they get mad at me for pushing the boundaries. For example, that would be someone. And I've had to do that with a couple people recently in my life, even though that I've seen them for years. It's like, sorry, this is just not, you know,
really? Working anymore. Even the ones you've had for years?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Well, it's honestly on me because like I will like look at the relationship and I think that's part of what makes me a good sex worker. But it's also kind of a downfall is that like, I see so much potential in my clients and potential for like where we could go together. meaningful way, if I want to put meaning into what this thing that we're doing that could be perceived as just completely meaningless, you know?
Yeah.
I'm like, where we could go together. And so I kind of hold on to that optimistic view, but then I have to take a step back and look at the actual behavior and like, oh, you know, this is actually something I need to reevaluate because I've been allowing my optimistic, idealistic view of you to color the actual reality mm-hmm. of the behavior that I'm seeing and experiencing. So
how do your clients react to like being let go?
I don't usually tell them.
You just like ghost them?
Yeah. I mean, or yeah.
Say you're busy or whatever. Be like, oh, I can't today.
Yeah, because the way that it's set up, like, I never reach out to my clients to spend time with them. They only ever, like, that's a big boundary that I have. Like, I will not infringe upon their life at all. There's a few exceptions. If I have, explicit permission, if I'm, say, visiting a certain city or something, and I'm told you can reach out to me when I'm there. Because, you know, I don't know what their lives are like, you know, who might be at their phone or, you know, their email, that kind of thing. So I don't ever reach out unless I have explicit permission. So because they're usually the ones coming to me, sometimes if it is a client that I've had for a long time, what usually happens is I'll restate my boundaries and they'll get upset about it and feel hurt. And then they just won't contact me again.
Noted.
When I'm clear about, okay, because that's what I want to do. I want to make it work to be able to continue these, you know, relationships that I have with people.
Of course.
So I try to communicate such that we can continue that in that relationship. But often in doing so, that is the end of the relationship because they can't, for whatever reason, accept it, or they feel like I'm being some type of way or something.
Isn't that funny?
I don't know.
Even in sex work, like, there's fucking relationship drama.
Yes. Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
It's just kind of funny that way. How do you feel about, we had this, oh, go ahead.
Oh, I was saying, that's the thing that's so sad. It's like, this is supposed to be like no strings attached, like this, like easy kind of thing. And it doesn't have to be as hard as you're making it. Anyway.
We talked about this last night. I wondered if you wanted to explore it today about this idea of like you're running a business and we're in America. And like when you run a business, like you're really just focused on making the money and like attaining goals. And so I wanted to ask you to discuss the idea of like your client's personal life, right? How important is it to you to know the details? Is it even necessary?
Oh, no, it's not necessary. With some clients, I will get to know a lot about their personal life if I, you know, have seen them for a long time. But that's always because they're offering that information. Often I don't really like to know the details because that can kind of like put me into a situation where it makes me... It does bring up some moral issues for me personally, if that makes sense.
Totally.
I'm providing a service. I don't want to, like, okay, so I'm just going to say it without.
Yeah.
Yeah. So men come to see me and they are often married. And so part of me is having this worry that I'm enabling cheating or that I'm somehow participating in like breaking people's marriages up or whatever. That's a worry that I hold. But then there's the other side of that where it's like, well, if a man is seeing a sex worker instead of maybe having an affair, like maybe it is more ethical way to cheat. But maybe that's just me rationalizing because I don't like to hold that burden. But also it is work. And people who come to see me, that's their action. They're taking the action to come to see me. It doesn't matter to me anything else. I'm just providing a service. Mm-hmm. I don't, the bigger part of me is like, no, I don't think it's like an ethical problem because it's not on me personally.
Right.
That part of me that is like kind of realizing the truth about the nature of what I do. You know, I don't want to like pretend that it's all, you know, easy and copacetic.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So. Okay. Obviously I struggle with this because like I take calls and some of my callers are cheaters. So like I think of myself and you and everything that we do as like hairstylists or therapists, we're confidants. We're people that people come to have no fear that we would go tell on them.
Right.
I do say to my callers, though, who, like, are cheaters, I was like, just don't put me in a room with your girlfriend or wife or husband, because I will tell them.
Yeah. But, like, my clients have a responsibility to be discreet so that I'm not brought into the mix of it. Yeah.
Exactly. Because the thing is, like, it's, like, I do consider what I do a business. And as a part of my business, I want my callers to feel like I'm going to protect their privacy. And then this is a bubble we're creating when we're together that doesn't really matter to the rest of the world because it's not like it's supposed to be a void, like a literal, like almost like a fake space in the universe that exists. Just us. So we can talk. Like right now we are talking and no one is in this room, but this is going to go to the public. So right. There's like got to be a way that I'm speaking to you that I would speak like I would speak to you differently if we weren't recording this. Right.
Yeah,
I want my callers to feel so comfortable with me that they can throw away all of the scripts, all of the fears. I'm not going to fucking call the PC police on you. I'm not going to call your wives. I just want you to be able to work out your shit with me so you can go back to your normal fucking life and maybe actually do better.
Right. Exactly. And that is the thing, too. Like, I think I've had clients before who have spent time with me and have kind of opened up about their lives. And I'd like to think that me being with them has helped them to improve maybe some issues in their personal lives. And I believe that it is possible and it is a thing that happens. So
I think so too. Like, I think there's something about when it's a job. Like, this sounds weird. You'd say in the same way that they need it to be taboo to help them pop that bubble. I think you also need it to be a business transaction for you to operate within the, like, because I also, you know how angry I get when it comes to cheating, girl. You heard me screaming on the Discord last night, girl. Like, I get really fucking pissed. But when it comes to my callers, when it comes to even people on OnlyFans or whatever else, like, when it comes to that, this is different to me. Because now we have the possibility of someone seeking out a healing process. Now, people do have affairs to heal themselves. I can't function within that framework. Like, my brain doesn't compute because I'm like, there's not even, like, it's because without the money, not that sex workers don't find love. Like, we got to find love, girl. But when there's money, it allows an opportunity to not even consider the romantic. Versus if it's like an affair, usually, and I just watched an evolutionary biologist talk about this, where he said that, you know, in a lot of relationships, men will cheat just for the sexual like satisfaction, but 70% of them will not leave their wives for you.
Right.
Right?
Exactly.
And then like,
exactly.
It's like one of those things where, again, so if you're having an affair, you might be doing it out of a romantic desire to like break up a marriage so you're with that person. If you're a sex worker, if you're like a me who takes calls, we're here to problem solve or allow satisfaction to occur in a moment of time in a bubble.
Yes. Yep.
You know, it's not like we're trying to introduce ourselves into their actual lives.
Right. And that's part of the reason why you can kind of look at it as more ethical if you're going to cheat to do it with a sex worker. Because yeah. It's way more messy to have an affair with just a regular person.
For sure.
Because, you know, they don't have the same boundaries that a sex worker has. I mean, obviously not all sex workers are the same, but right. If you do your research and find a, you know, professional in, you know, with a good reputation, they're not going to make your personal life messy. That's bad for business, you know? So in that sense, it's maybe more ethical to hire a sex worker than to actually have an affair in, you know, with someone from work or whatever.
Now, can we talk about, because I'm sure someone thought about it because I'm thinking about it. Well, sex workers are people and people can also be messy and sex workers could show up to your door and be messy. But that's because,
yeah.
Like,
there are those sex workers, yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So then, and like...
all that, yeah.
But like you said, if you go to a professional enough sex worker, hopefully you're paying for, mm-hmm. like, a respectable sex worker who's going to do good, yeah. by the client.
Yeah, and there's research that you can do to, like, try and ensure that you're hiring that kind of a sex worker. You know, do they have a presence online on social media? Do they have a website? Some providers allow reviews. You can look up, some don't. But there's ways that you can really make sure that they're, get a sense for who they are. And if they're the type of person you want to spend time with and give money to.
So. Can we talk about falling in love? Because there's always this imagery I see on YouTube, that bubble, where people are like, nobody even, like, fucks the girls on OnlyFans, bro. Nobody actually gets to fuck the porn star. Nobody actually gets to date the porn star. But, like, sex workers are people. We want to fall in love.
Mm-hmm.
So, like...
Oh, yeah.
Like, talk about that, like, personal experience about, like, falling in love. And then, because, like, you know, that's, like, my biggest thing. I just want a person who isn't threatened by the fact that I'm naked on the internet.
Well, I mean, for someone who's like you or like me, it's actually a really good kind of litmus test. That's kind of what I've come down to, because at one point I was really, like, really thinking about, like, should I even be doing sex work if I want love, you know, if I want real love eventually, yeah. at some point. Because it just seems to be something that so many men are just, either they have insecurities around it or their belief systems or whatever. They're not open to being in a relationship with a sex worker. But I value people who are more introspective and can, like, look beneath those things. And so me being a sex worker actually affords a very easy way to shut out the people who I don't really want to be entering into a relationship with anyway.
Right.
There's just going to be less people in general who are open to being in a relationship with you. But for someone like me, that's probably a good thing. There's not a lot of people who would really be a good match for me anyway.
That's, I mean,
there
saying.
Is a world, but, like, in compared to maybe what other people experience as their, I don't know, playing field.
No, 100%. So, okay, so obviously, realistically, the best way for me to secure a partner is to use the internet. Because I literally live on purpose in the middle of a forest in a small conservative town of like 12,000 people. I love it here, would never give it up. So I have to utilize a tool that's accessible to me. And I happen to be a girl who is naked on the internet with a lot of leaked photos. Kids, let's Google Brittany Simon OnlyFans leak. Great stuff. Just posted a great set of videos. So if you guys are interested. But, like, it's one of those things, right, where I love my work. Yesterday I did this, like, little, just like a little thing on my phone. And I was like, this is hot. And, like, I posted it. And I was, like, really feeling myself. But it's, like, one of those things where I, in my head, I want them to understand. In my head, all I'm thinking is, my tits look really fucking good. I'm going to put that on the internet. I'm not sitting here thinking, I'm going to take men's money. And, like, I'm not sitting here. I'm just literally being so vain.
Right. Yeah. I mean, that is part of it for me, like, the artistic kind of side of it. But I have to admit, when I post those pictures, I am thinking about the clients I'm attracting.
What do you mean by that? What do you mean by that?
I mean, men are, maybe this is a very stereotypical thing to say, but working in sex work has taught me that it might have some truth to it, but men are very visual.
Yes.
Oh, and so pictures are going to draw them in to want to see you.
Yes.
More than just, like, your personality. Like, let's be honest. Personality plays a part of it for a lot of people, but it's the visual that is probably the most important. So when I post pictures, it is very, very much in a way to attract clients.
Always. Don't get me wrong. I always take, like, a set of photos and I'm like, and this is done for to put out there, right? And then this is done just because I'm feeling myself, which, honestly, I have to fight a lot of insecurities when I'm feeling myself, because then I'm more natural, but then I worry that it's not going to be good for the client because they want the visual stimulation they need.
Yes. Yeah. I think about that all the time. I do have a mask that I put on, but it's also very much a part of me. It's very much a part of me. My persona online, my sex work persona, I view it as a good thing, as a tool. My mask is a tool to help me enter into that world and take on all the like little procedural knowings of like how to be a sex worker. Yeah. And like, okay, I'm in this arena, I'm doing this thing, I'm putting this mask on, and I know how to act within this space.
Yeah.
And it helps me.
Yeah.
Where I find it difficult is in civilian dating, like, where does my mask come into play? Like, obviously I want to dress up and look nice, but that kind of clicks my brain into like going into, you know, professional world. And yeah, then that's not a good setup for a relationship, because it's basically me just fulfilling all the fantasies and desires of the person and not, you know, receiving anything. So of course people fall in love with that and want to be with that, but then I'm kind of left bereft.
Yeah.
So it's difficult for me to find that balance of like, how much of my real self do I need to like show, and in what instance? And it is all part of my real self, but how much of that mask do I peel off, and with who and when? It's complicated.
Yeah.
It's complicated. All the right actions to take.
Well, I think you know how obsessed I am with parts. So, like, there's always, like, a lot of parts in a human, but then there's the core parts of us. And there's a part of Brittany that has to be naked. Like, she just exists. I don't know why she's there. Like, she will post for free. I started on free Tumblr. I started walking around Seattle naked. Like, there's just something in my brain that's like, we should be naked.
Yeah.
That sounds like a good idea. Now, the nudity even has a different relationship, though, based off of the energy. So how much of sex work is like BDSM in terms of like energy exchange, right? Because I...
Yeah.
Right? So
those are clients, yeah.
Those are your favorite clients? Okay, so there you go. But even with dating, like in your own personal vanilla life, like when you're dating regular people, right? You're right. Like the clothes we wear, how we do our hair. Even today, I was like, okay, I feel like really ick today. My skin's awful. I'm like having like a big breakout. And I'm like, wow, this is so weird. How do I feel good? Well, I'm going to just dress up. And if I'm extra cute, I'm going to feel precious. But I don't really feel very toppy right now. I don't really feel very... I just feel kind of like a girl.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, that mood is not the same mood I'm in when I'm dominating somebody or, like, I'm in a top space.
Yes. Yeah.
So my sex worker brain is also just like any of those other Britneys. Like, she is a real person, but she's not mm-hmm. that person all the time in the same way that no one is. Now, the dream is to have a person, right, girl, who sees all of me at the same time, and I can be all those Britneys, like, in the span of, like, the same 10 seconds.
Yes. Yeah.
That's
and they're not
my goal.
They're weirded out by that. They get it, and they see it completely for who you are. Yeah.
Exactly. Yep. So, in other words, I just want to be free.
Mm-hmm.
Free to be me, because you're right. Otherwise, we're masking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And it's really hard. It's really hard to break out of that mask if you want to, if you're so used to using it in a certain, like, setting.
Well, so. just for, like, okay, this is what I'm learning in my life. Is that I'm such an open person on the internet, but I'm realizing as much as I'm open, I'm very closed. I have, like, major problems with, like, the moment someone asks me a real question, I'm like,
okay. Yeah.
Like, I can answer, Brittany, what's your vagina look like? It's awesome. It's beautiful. She's an outie, not an innie. Like, I could go on about my vagina, but if somebody looked at me and said, how do you really feel about your vagina? I'd be like, whew. That's
yeah.
a heavy question, bro.
Yeah, and so many different layers to it and parts to it, and yeah.
A lot of shame.
Yes.
With my own vagina.
Mm-hmm. I was just thinking about that. Like, there's probably not one single part of my body that I haven't felt shame for.
Mm.
And like, wow. Mm. You know, like, what?
And I want to be able to talk to somebody about that. So when we imagine falling in love, I'm not imagining this person. Like, I told you, I've gone on so many dates in the last couple of years. Just a few that just, like, this, I know I talk about him all the time, but it just, like, will throw me for the rest of my life that a man went on a date with me and then was like, who buys OnlyFans? That's so stupid. And I'm like, I don't understand what this conversation is. Like, why you want to date with me, bro?
Yeah. I've dated people like that who say they're very open to me being a sex worker, but then they'll say things like, oh, I could never hire a sex worker. Like, why would I hire an escort?
I'm so much better than that. Like, why would I do that?
So then I'm like, oh, well, like, what are you really, like, if you would never, what are you really thinking about the fact that I am a sex worker? Like, what is that actually saying? You're communicating so much through that statement, even though you say that you're very open to me being one.
So, okay, so. Do you get, like, the savior complex for them? I'm assuming they're trying to save you, because that's what I get. Why are people trying to save us?
Yes, a lot. Or it's either they are trying to save me, or they feel really insecure because they can't save me. Because they don't have money to, like, retire me or whatever. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wait a second. That is such a fun thought. So, wait, they want to have a dream of, like, retiring? I know that's a theme, like, amongst some clients of, like, I'm going to retire her. But, like, what do they get when they actually do that? And does it maintain into a long-term relationship? Or don't they, right. like, does that even translate?
And why do they want to retire me? Like, why? Let's really talk about that. That's what I want to do. People who say those kind of things. Like, okay. Like, why? Really, really, why do you want to retire me? Is it actually because you don't like that I'm doing this? Is it because, sorry, I have to plug in my phone. Hang on a second.
Do it. This is perfect. I'll put the sponsor stuff in right here. Literally, this candle, I'm gonna die. It's so good. Oh. And it's so pretty. Ooh, actually, let me take a picture of this candle now that the wax is, like, melted and it's, like, swimming.
Oh, my God. Same. I have so many. I'm always so self-conscious of my house smelling good or bad.
Literally. And I'm always, like, I love going to the store with my brothers because they all love candles, too. And I just love going and, like, candle shopping with them. It's, like, such a nice vibe to have a bunch of, like, This one? It's like, and then we're all, you know, talk about weird intimacy, candle intimacy. Like, just looking at someone saying, what smell do we want to smell in our home?
Yeah. Yeah, for real. Like, do you like fruity or do you like woodsy and, like, you know, musky? What would smell? Yes.
Would you stop dating someone based off of what candles they liked in their home? If they were like, this is the smell I like, period, but it smelled like banana, which we know is the worst.
Ugh. Probably not. I probably wouldn't stop dating them because it's not that important to me, but it would be weird.
It would be weird. There's just certain things people do. So, like, for me, I have such a strong nose, though. The girl, God gave me this nose for a reason. And so, like, I can just smell everything. And so a part of me would be like, no, like, change the scent, find something we both like, because I'm not living the rest of my life smelling something I don't want to smell. But...
Yeah, that's true. See, I admire that so much about you. You just know what you want. And for me, I'm like, nah, I could live with that. But, like, I really don't know if I could live with it until I try and then realize I fucking can't, you know?
Do you know what? But you should know this. You come from a big family. I swear growing up with big families teaches you the differences between personalities in a way, if I look at it that way, because I, like... My siblings and I will do that. We'll be like, I don't want to date someone like you, though. I want to date someone like you more, but not even like your trope, but like your trope. So it actually gives you an example of like different kinds of people that exist in the world because your siblings are often so diverse, you know?
Yeah, they really, really are very diverse. And I have siblings that I'm much more close with than others. And actually, my youngest brother is the one I'm probably the closest with. He's the most like we're the most similar. And like, he's very introspective as well. And like... Cute. Yeah.
I love that. No, little brothers, like little siblings are me too. I mean, I have three of them living with me right now. And it's just so nice. And it's just like, it's so, but it's like, that's what I'm saying. Our life has given us tools to put together enough what we want, but we have to actually ask ourselves that going back to the beginning of the conversation, why, right? Mm-hmm. Like, why do we feel this way? Why are we having this thought? What does this thought mean? And same when we're dating, when people say like, I don't want to date a girl on OnlyFans. I don't want to date a girl who's naked on the internet. What are you really having a problem with? Fair, if you're like in a specific, like if you're in a Catholic bubble or religious bubble, that makes sense. That alone is a good reason. I'm like, yeah, you're religious. Like, why would you date like, why?
Perfect. Exactly. That's kind of what I was going for when I said like me being a sex worker actually helps me like narrow the playing field. And so I know like that's one thing that I do know through experience. Like, this is a good thing for me to use to weed out the people who are not good fits for me anyway. Totally. So
I love on a first date just being like, I'm naked on the internet, thoughts.
Yeah.
And then just having people, because I love, like, it's not that I'm trying to, like, scare people away, but, like, girl, I, like you said, I know what I want. Mm-hmm. I already know the life I want. Actually, one of the, I was on a date once, and he asked me, like, if we had kids, how sex positive do we want to be around the kids? And that was, like, one of the greatest questions a man has ever asked me.
Yeah.
And I was like, great fucking question. Like, if I'm doing OnlyFans, when do we want to tell the kids I'm doing OnlyFans?
Yeah.
Like, great fucking question.
That is a very good question. I think about stuff like that all the time.
How could you know that? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, with kids, it's like, it's just like being a sexual adult. Like, when you have children, it's the same thing. It's not like you have them around when you're having sex. You know what I mean?
Well, do you, though? That was the question that came up in the conversation. Really great conversation. Like, what if we're at home and what if we're, like, making love and the kid walks in? Do we, like, panic or do we go, okay, mom and dad are busy. You need to turn around and you need to give us space. You need to learn how to knock on doors, right? Love you. And, like, do one
Yeah, you teach the child so much more about, like, what's happening through, like, your nonverbals than through your verbals. So if they, you know, walk in on you having sex and then you freak out, what message are you sending them?
Right.
Whereas if you're like, oh, mommy and daddy are having mommy and daddy time, you need to go somewhere else and it's chill, and they're like, oh, okay, this is normal.
Totally.
It's traumatic. But it's when it kind of reminds me, like, in my former life, I worked as a toddler teacher at a daycare center.
Cute.
Speaking of jack of all trades. I just like to of all ages. But I remember we used to go outside and the kids would, like, find bugs and stuff. And I really had to train myself not to freak out when they'd bring me a spider. Because, like, you know, that could really change their perception of you
absolutely.
Know. I had to be like, oh, you look at, you know, I had to really, like, teach myself to, like, body language and, like, everything, you know, that not kids- to, like, yeah. And it's the same with, like, any kind of situation. And I think we just are like, oh, sex, because it's like we separate children from sex so much, which obviously we should, you know.
Right.
But if we can, like, train ourselves to be chill about it, like, it's not a big deal to the kids.
Right. So. No, you're 100% correct. Kids 100% read the body language. They're looking at you. They're wondering what you're trying to convey. Actually, I was thinking about that in terms of, like, because I grew up in such a loud Middle Eastern family. Even now as an adult, I completely read people's body language very differently than other humans. So, like, people will watch me react to Sneeko and everyone's like, he's so angry. I'm like, is that anger? Because, like, in my family, anger is very specific. And, like, yelling and being loud is not angry. It's like, you can call it angry if you would like, that's fine, but it's kind of like,
you know what 19-year-old boys are like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah.
Like, even yesterday when I was, like, yelling about the cheating stuff on the Discord, it's like, it's just like, this is like an area in which, like, it brings out my veins and my neck, but I'm like, literally as I'm as I'm yelling on Discord, I'm also DMing my friends like, la, 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 la. Like, we're not, like, I'm not taking the energy I have about a subject and, like, projecting upon my whole life. But some people do that. Some people take one feeling they have about one thing and project it onto their whole life. So, like, sex work, and then project it onto their whole life. Or BDSM, or what things look like. And so I just want to encourage people to consider that you don't have to project this one bubble your own life if you have to. If you need to put yourself in a mind space where you're like, I'm in a mom bubble right now, I am sex worker bubble right now, I'm this bubble right now, I do that throughout my whole life. Which Brittany am I?
You think that's because of your ability to introspect, though? You know what I mean? Or to use your language, the fact that you're 5? Because I think a lot of people carry a lot of different feelings of shame about different aspects of their life, and because they don't see it for what it is, that's when it bleeds out onto the rest of their life. They carry it around with them. They carry the shame as like, oh, I am bad or whatever because of this one area of their life or this one thing. Instead of being like, no, this one area, I can go here and here and, like, have a completely different experience of life.
Does that make sense?
Yeah,
totally. I think you are right. If I'm being honest, I think that is, yes, I obviously have collected a lot more tools than the average person.
Yeah.
So what I'm not saying like you should be able to have this. I'm saying you can work towards a life where you have it, but it is work. So yes, I'm you're right. I should preface every podcast with, I have 1,000 more tools than you. Like, I just do. Like when I watch men, like, what did I just cover the other day? And I was like, why is he limiting himself? When I was like, don't you want more tools? But people don't. They want the tools that make sense within the game they're playing.
That's what I was going to say. For them, that bubble or whatever it is, it completely works for the rest of their life. The other areas of their life. And so the consequence of that is that they're going to like do that where they're going to like take one aspect and one area of shame or whatever, and it's going to bleed into the rest of their life. But that's because that's like part of the nature of the bubble, I think. Like, you have to like completely be immersed in it. And when you are completely immersed in it, sometimes that affords like all this great meaning and all this great beauty and love and joy. But sometimes it affords all this shame and all this like negative emotion and feeling that, and it all bleeds into your whole life. That's totally. Like when bubbles are like really strong like that, I think that can happen a lot to people. But it's like give or take, you know. Well, if I give up shame, I have to also give up all this other stuff that I really value and I put all this meaning into. So
that's why I think, because you're born in a bubble, so shame is like when you've betrayed the values of your like culture and bubble or whatever, the people around you, right? I think there's comfort in that because you get attention. You get noticed. Like, growing up in a house of, like, 10 kids, I noticed that some of my siblings were neglected when they were good people. Like, better kids, like, good at school. Because the parents would say, well, they've got it handled. I'm going to focus on the kid that's a mess. But then that kid is like, well, look at me. I'm doing everything correctly. And I'm, like, I'm not getting any attention from my parents. So maybe I should rebel so I can get attention. Then my parents are like, oh, another kid is rebelling. And I was like, okay, but, like, we all made the mistake of doing this with our life. And so that makes us just miss out. So when I think of tools, I think of tools as something that's doing this. And I'm like, oh, okay, cool.
Yes, reciprocal openings.
But yes. What is the consequence? You possibly could move away from a bubble, leave the church, be gay, do sex work. Oh no, become the thing that like, everyone's like, no, like my parents growing up, ask questions, question the church. Oh, but don't leave the church. What are you doing?
Yes, exactly. That's same thing with my parents. Because, you know, as you know, my background is very similar to yours. Big family, Catholic family, that kind of thing. And it's like, they're so convinced, oh, if people question and like are searching for the truth, they'll eventually find God. And that's not what happened for me.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think my family look just the way that they view it is, well, my search isn't over yet.
Totally. You
know, and they know I'm going to find God if I keep searching.
Well,
if I don't, it's because I didn't search well or something. It's not because God, of course it couldn't be because God is not real.
100%. But you know, can I say, like, there is a part of my brain that goes, they're probably right, but not about God, but kind of about God.
Yeah.
Right? Like, they are probably, there is something in me that's always like, are you the thing I'm looking for? Are you the thing I'm looking for? And my parents will always say, Brittany, that thing you're looking for is God. I'm like, maybe. God-shaped hole. What did you say?
Oh, by the way, the God-shaped hole thing.
Yes. Wait, that it's like missing inside of you. Is that the thing?
Yeah. Yep.
That's what I'm saying. So like, it kind of makes sense. Like there is, but I think the drive or the, well, for me, it's the curiosity. Like, and, like, the Catholics I grew up around are very philosophy-based Catholics. They read all the books. They explore all the ideas. So they're not like, simple thinkers, but they are always going to default to God, which is simple thinking.
Yes. Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, it does make sense. Default to God, whereas it's like, okay, well, I can look at the same tendency that I have and come up with, like, a million different philosophical conclusions, maybe not conclusions, but like questions. Just more questions. The more questions you have, the more questions you discover.
Well, what is that whole ignorant?
Well, that hole inside of us, like maybe it just comes from like our consciousness, and that like that maybe is just like the tragic part of what it is to be a human, which is to be a meaning-making machine. even though we are like also like faced with the fact that reality on the macro level is meaningless. And so we're going to always have this hole because we want to make meaning. Like, we need to make meaning because that's how we get an optimal grip on our arena and we use it. And that's how we become like so adaptive as a species and like that we've like been so successful. So like we have to have the meaning, but like ultimately there is no meaning. And so we're like faced with this like dilemma. And I think that's the hole. That's the hole.
Yeah.
Is like being meaning making machines in a meaningless world.
Yeah.
So it's a different in question, but maybe that's what God is too. So,
well, first of all, every time you say meaning, I hear verveiki.
Yeah, same.
You know,
I'm trying hard not to just like be a verveiki puppet. But
we love verveiki. Be a verveiki puppet. Yeah. No, the Discord discussing verveiki on a weekly basis has been like the greatest thing that ever happened to that Discord. And I'm sad I'm always behind, but that's what I mean. Verveiki is a tool that exists on the internet. And if you want, for free, you can watch this whole series he's done on exploring the meaning crisis. And you can ask yourself, what is this hole inside of me? And you're right. I think on the micro-macro level, so God is macro to religious people. But I would argue they're going beyond God is macro.
Yeah.
Because God is just this, like, beautiful relationship humans have with themselves. He's a representation of that relationship.
Okay, verveiki puppet time. God is a participatory symbol that affords self-transcendence. That, that's the God that I believe in. Like, he's very real because we make him real. Because we have this idea of this thing of God. And because of that idea of this thing of God that we have, we can reach parts of ourselves that we couldn't reach before. Because we think something bigger than us is controlling it all, and so then we're freed to like act and move in ways that we couldn't if we didn't believe that.
Yes.
So my out as someone who's lost that belief, I'm like, how do I like grasp hold of that like affordance that belief has? Because a belief really can afford self-transcendence.
Yes. Well, which is why we have to be very this is what I'm saying. So usually the typical story in America was my story, right? You grow up religious, you leave religion, you hate religion, you read Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris and like Christopher Hitchens, and then you join the atheist movement, and then you hate religion, and then you fight religion, and then you actually grow out of that because you're like, what am I doing? Why am I like shutting down religion in the same way they are shutting down me? That's stupid. So then you move out of that bubble and you go into the bubble of like maybe politics or something. You're looking for meaning. So I looked for it in the feminist bubble and the queer bubble, and I was like, where is this meaning? Not finding it anywhere, girl. It just like wasn't existing for me. So I was like, okay, what is this? And then I had to go through this whole journey, which many of you know, obviously, where I was like, what is going on? Which is where the levels came about and everything else. Because even outside of all those bubbles, like I thought I was literally blowing my mind. I was like, Black Lives Matter and the government and white supremacy. And then I realized like even those are bubbles constructed by the fear of people who all live together and created this new problem that we're all facing together. But like we created it. The world is a reflection of our participation in it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I think that.
Anything else? How could it be anything else?
How could it be anything else? But who is it? It's always over there. It's always that person there. It's always this person here. It's never.
Well, and I wonder too if that's part of the reason that it's so easy for some people to believe in God, because there is kind of this nature of humans that is like both very solitary and alone, but it's also, there's this other aspect that's very like intertwined with all other humans. Like if humanity, we create these societies and we create all these different, like we can't really do much of anything just on our own by ourselves. And right. So that connectedness that we have to other people is a very real thing that is in a sense bigger than ourselves. So it gives us that kind of feeling that like, we are kind of tied to aspects of like biggerness.
Yeah.
But we're also like completely alone at the same time. Like there's aspects of us that like nobody else will ever see or ever know. Right. Like just because we are tied to our own perspective.
Yeah.
Like our perspective of the subjective is always going to be subjective because we're tied to our perspective.
Right.
So in that, we're always alone in that perspective. But there's also aspects of us that are like completely intertwined and completely together that can never be torn apart from other people. And that's, to me, that truth of what it is to be human also points to how maybe people could believe in a God, if that makes sense. Does that follow?
No, it's beautiful. Actually, it translates right perfectly into the idea of, like, we've been talking a lot about in the Discord about high trust, low trust. Like, high trust societies, low trust societies. How I am currently in a bubble where, like, our neighbors have extremely high trust in one another. Like, it's just a very trusting neighborhood. But then again, all of us also have guns, and all of us will kill each other if we want to. And so there's a part of you that, because there's, like, a sense of violence, there's a sense of safety. Mm-hmm. But because we never use the violence, it feels also safe.
Yes. It's like, all so those weird things wouldn't constrict each other. That's where we live. We live in the middle of all these tensions of, like, different ends of the spectrum, like, pulling against each other, but also affording and making way for each other. It's just kind of this, like, orb of just...
Yeah.
What is it? What is Verveke calls it? He calls it, not parasitic processing. Oh, opponent processing.
Mm.
That just depends where we are.
Oh, anyway. I love that. Well, okay, wait. So wait, this translates to this idea of, like, even with sex workers... Sex workers are people who could lie, personify themselves, objectify themselves to get clients, to make money, and then to throw a client away, which creates, like, a low trust in the client or the people perceiving sex work. But then on the other side of it, there could be the sex workers that do have a persona, that create a bubble, allow energy to occur to best facilitate a satisfying moment with their clients, which makes the sex worker money.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And all of these things are sex work, but that would, I hope, encourage a high trust energy. And maybe because of our experiences, me being a sex worker, you being a sex worker, we trust ourselves. We know we're good people. So in my head, I have high trust with sex workers because I assume they're like me. But then I know those bubbles of sex workers where I'm like, I ain't working with you, girl.
Yeah,
I know your vibe. I know the way you treat your clients. I don't like it. You know what I'm saying? But it's not virtue signaling. It's just adhering to my own values. So I'm not, like, on the internet saying all sex workers are gross except for me. I'm the pick me sex worker. No, fuck that.
Tempted to do that. Like, if I see drama on online on the sex in the sex work community, I'm just like, girl, sit the fuck down. Like, look at you trying to do the exact same thing. You know, like,
So, like, when we have these interactions and we're coming up against each other, even sex workers, just like you said, we, like, look at each other and we're like, what are you doing? And then we get upset because we're like, if you do that, you're going to make the bubble think I'm like you. And then you're going to make my job harder. So then it becomes a hierarchy of, well, who's better? And I'm like, oh, my God. Like, all of these layers versus.
But that is in every single bubble. That pattern is in every single freaking bubble. All the time.
All of it. Everywhere. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. I really believe all humans are the same, that we run in cycles, that we are tropes and categories, that we are individuals with free will. I do believe in free will personally. And I think you can utilize that free will on a deeper level based off of your introspection level. But if you just sit up here up top where you're at the surface and you're thinking, look, I can see everything, you're missing all of the world down below. So I don't think of life as, like, I think of the iceberg, how the tip is so deceiving because it's actually this huge thing that lives under the ocean. But everyone goes, but if you're at the tip, you're at the surface, so you see everything. I'm like, there's an ocean underneath you.
You keep yourself into thinking you see everything.
Exactly. Mm. So in our heads, we think the surface is the answer. And I'm saying we got to dig deeper, bitch. We got to dive deep so we understand the depth of our souls, the depth of us. Isn't that why it's deep? Like, we want to go deeper.
Yes.
But we're afraid because it's dark. Much like an ocean, literally scares the fuck out of me, girl. But you know the mystery there is good.
Yeah.
It might be even worth dying for. That's the question. I was willing to die for introspection. I still am. Mm. I'm so reckless. But I gotta know why.
Yeah, and beautiful, though. Like,
yeah, I think so.
Because if you respect deep enough, you can really radically accept death and see it for really what it is, which death affords new life. So it's just a part of, I know that sounds cheesy and whatever to say, but it's really true. Death is a very necessary part of life.
Okay. But those, I've said this, like, a lot over the last few months, those cheesy sayings, those Hallmark feelings, those simple answers, I think is the answer. I think we're so distracted by looking for this, like, zened out master who lives in the mountains. Like, somebody asked me on the Discord months and months and months ago. The monk who's, like, never left the village and is, like, virginal and sitting on a mountaintop, like, zenning out. Are they fives? And I'm like, no. What do you know the fuck about life? No wonder you're zenning out, bro. You've never touched pussy. You're busy zenning out in a forest. Like, what the fuck? No, you have to live life and experience the hardships of existence and then tell me you can zen out.
Yeah, and you're... what even is the word I'm looking for? But, like, your being, your essence, your becoming emerges from those experiences. It's kind of like, reminds me of, like, why heaven never made much sense to me. Because how could it be perfect if there's no struggle, if there's no suffering for? Because the suffering defines the joy. Just like darkness defines the light and the light defines the darkness. Like, it just doesn't philosophically make sense to me. You have to go through in order to become. You can't just, yeah.
In your bubble, I was raised in the Catholic bubble that told me that God will only send you to heaven if you want to go there. Meaning.
Yeah.
Like, same. Okay, so I was thinking about that. And so for a lot of my life, I did internalize this desire to go to hell only because the way heaven was described to me sounded awful.
Yeah.
It sounded like without stimulation. They told me that I would be joyful and never feel pain and that I would, like, sing praise to God. And I was like, okay, but, like, where is the stimulation? And then did you see this movie called What Dreams May Come? Is that what it's called, with Robin Williams?
Seen that movie before.
Yeah, you know, where he goes to hell and he's, like, looking for his wife. That movie, oh my God, my depression, relatable. But, like, when she's in hell and she's just, like, sitting there and she's, like, in her own creepy, like, like, her own depression bubble, she can't hear him, right?
Yeah.
And I looked at that, though, and I thought, you know what? I think my life has been so relatable to her that if that's hell, I can do it again for eternity, girl.
Mm.
I've already done it for 33 years.
Yeah.
You know, but at the same time,
yeah,
I think that it affords her an ability, like, even her room is, like, one where she can get up and walk around. But she just chooses not to. But in heaven, I'm told that I'm going to praise God every day and I'm not going to have a lot of choice about what I do. And that's interesting to me. But then in hell, you don't either, right?
Choice in heaven, if it's perfect. Like, it don't,
But maybe that's us holding on to our egos.
That's true. It could be.
Because listen to us. Like, we're literally in heaven. We're like, yes, but can I watch anime? It's like, do you really want to watch anime if you're in heaven, bitch? Like, is that really what you want? So then the question is, are we projecting our idea of, like, our suffering as perfection and non-suffering as, like, because I do look at people who don't suffer and I'm like, questionable.
I mean, yeah, and I think about that too. Like, is my complete acceptance and almost, like, love of my suffering just the way that I've kind of learned how to cope with it?
Yes. Like, do we romanticize it enough to stay in love with it?
Exactly. Like, is that how I accept it?
And is true freedom letting go of the suffering?
Yeah.
Or is the true freedom embracing the suffering?
Yeah.
I think it's both.
Yeah.
It's gotta be both.
Let go of the suffering. What else are you letting go of, though? That's my question.
What else can you embrace now that you've let something go and made space for something else?
Hmm.
Right? Okay, so when you're... Okay. So, like, I'm learning new things about myself recently. And I'm learning that like I said, I'm open. But when it actually comes to making room, I am very hard to budge.
Mm, yeah.
And so, like, I've created, like, a space in a lot of ways by being, like, a partner who can make money and a partner who's going to buy a home and a partner who can provide for having babies and all that stuff. Like, in a lot of ways, I've made room for somebody. But when it gets down to the real conversation about, like, is there room for me in your life? It's like, great question.
Mm.
How much am I actually interested in making room for somebody, or do I just like to pretend that I am? How much am I actually excited about sex work, or how much do I pretend that I am? How much do I love YouTube, but I just kind of, like, am here? Like, how much? And I keep thinking about all my choices. Like, I have a person in my life who's always like, I want to get married. But I was like, but you don't do anything to get married to the woman you say you want to attract. So do you want to get married? Like, do you want this? Or do you actually, like, have a perfectly good life? Like, you're well-traveled, you're educated, you have a place, you have a good job. Like, maybe you're just kind of happy. You socialize, you're extroverted, you're always out. Like, do you want to fall in love, like, to a nice Christian lady who's going to stay at home and have your babies when you make 40K? Like, is that really what your goal is? Or is your goal to, like, enjoy your life and have a lot of fun, which you're doing? And so I had to ask myself, am I really facilitating the life I want? Am I really reaching for heaven? Or am I actually just comfortable in hell?
Mm.
And that's what I've been, like, asking myself all of, you know, all of this time.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's poignant.
Because if we love suffering, because it leads us to introspection, how much of this is just self-harming to make sure we're still alive?
Yeah, at what point do we, like, at what point do we emerge from the suffering? I guess that's my thing. Like, for me, I look at the suffering kind of in a past tense. Like, I definitely still can suffer a lot.
Yes.
Like, because I'm just very strong-willed and stubborn and, like, it's a pattern and it's comfortable and familiar for me. So I strong-willed, stubbornly stick to my suffering.
Yeah.
But I also look at the suffering in my past and how that kind of shaped me. Like, my unique suffering afforded my unique joy as well.
Yeah.
But at one point, yeah, you're right. Like, because of seeing that and, like, kind of, like, experiencing self-transcendence by making that observation of, like, how suffering and joy are combined, like, do I cling to the suffering now because of seeing that pattern from the past? Mm-hmm. And I might make my life more miserable than I need to.
So I have an allowance I give myself of self-harm I'm allowed to participate in.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, there are, like, my favorite form of self-harm is neglect. What?
Oh, I'm just going to say, and that's kind of where, like, sex work / BDSM comes into play, because I think we like to play around with that suffering.
Yes.
In order to, like, manipulate that machinery of, like, suffering affording self-transcendence and joy.
Yes.
It's like we're purposefully doing it instead of just, like, entering into the, like, flow of suffering in life, you know?
Yes.
We're, like, hold of it and saying, no, I want to, like, create the suffering because I want to self-transcend, and doing it, like, very purposefully.
Yes, that's cool. With intent, right? So yeah. I allow sex work BDSM to be this tool that I explore safely and without self-harming. Then I self-harm sometimes through neglect to feel, this is going to sound so weird, to feel like my old suffering self, because I'm so happy and so joyful every day. I miss her.
Yeah, there's, like, a nostalgia for her.
Yeah.
Yes. there is something so delicious about, like, that angst that we would feel, you know, that like, when you've come out of your heal, or, yeah, come out of your trauma and you're healed, that's, like, you can look back and you can appreciate the beauty and the suffering, and so you kind of almost miss it.
Yes.
It's like a friend. It's like, oh. Like a friend who died, or like
100%
way that you can't embrace anymore, even though you're happy where you are. It's like that part of you, just like you remember what it was like to be in that moment.
Yeah,
and you be in it too. Even though
again, your audio cut off. You want to be in it too. It's me. You're fine. It's the audio of like when I'm talking and you're talking, the audio wants to like compensate for it. But I wanted to hear what you just said. You said the last sentence.
Oh yeah. You want to be in that suffering, but even though when you were in it in the moment, it was probably, you were experiencing it in a different way than looking back on it.
The worst.
Yeah.
It was the worst pain of my life. Mm-hmm. I literally was trying to kill myself. I was in so much pain.
Yeah.
So why the fuck in my joy am I like, miss it?
See, I wonder if it's because, like, hindsight is 20/20, and when you look back, like, you've come to where you are because of emerging from that suffering. And so we can't escape our new perspective now.
Mm.
So we're looking back on it through the perspective that we have, through our subjectivity. Like, we're looking back on it, and we can't escape. So we can see the value of it in a way that we couldn't when we were going through it. And that's maybe part of the reason why it was so dark when we were going through it, because we couldn't see what it would afford us in the future.
Yes. And, okay, I had this thought in the shower today. This is crazy. I had this thought in the shower. I used to, because I was so in my borderline and depression stuff, and I had a DS relationship, I would do this thing in the shower where I would, like, almost, like, disassociate on purpose, but I would, like, and then I would, like, literally zone out my eyes so, like, I wasn't even a person. And we would play around with that. But because I was actually always fighting, like, actual disassociation, I couldn't experience an out-of-body experience without actually fucking myself over. But now I'm almost sure I could recreate it safely through BDSM and sex because my disassociation is, like, 3 years in the past, though it could come back, right? It's, like, so far from me. I'm like, oh, I wonder if I could do this as a role play and allow my partner, because you know what, my partner, poor ex-partner, but like he would have a moment of doubt where he's like, wait, are we doing a consensual BDSM thing? Or are you literally having a medical problem? I'm like, great question. Don't know. I'm manic. both? Like, I don't know. And then that's why negotiation is so important for me. And so I know how to communicate to my partners and they can check in with me. But again, that's because I think I play around with darkness so much. It's like a good anime. Like, you can dive into the darkness, but you gotta have a way to get yourself out, boo-boos. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're just gonna fall in there forever and you're not gonna get out.
Yes. You can fall into the abyss on your way to your bliss, as Alanis would say.
Love it. Love it. The great philosopher. Okay. Now, yeah. I am coming up on time because I have a thing to do in about 20 minutes-ish, so we have a little bit of a cushion. What else is on your mind today? Because this, by the way, best podcast to come back. This is so good, girl. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thank you. No, I'm honestly, you know me. Like, I think that's one of the things that just has always drawn me to you is that, like, our brains are very, like, we're riding a similar wave.
Yeah.
And so whenever we talk, it just, like, opens up and affords just great, like, self-questing as well as just, like, conversation. So, yeah.
Yes.
It's awesome. Yes. You know, I love talking.
I had this great imagery in my head. Have you seen Ponyo? It's a Miyazaki film.
Yeah.
Ponyo, you know how she's like riding on the water? She like runs on the water. I imagine that we're both like running on the water and then we see each other and sometimes our waves smash together and we're riding together and then sometimes they fall back apart and we're like, bye. And I just love that about our friendship. Like, I feel like we come in and out of each other's life like perfectly, you know? And how did that start? The internet, which brings me back to the original point I was making. The internet is your key to finding your people.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think you're right about
that. Right? So, anything else on your mind?
No.
No?
I mean,
we did good.
Always, but nothing specific.
Perfect.
So.
Okay, I am going to link your stuff in the description, yes?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Then I will share your social medias there. Is there anything else you want the audience to know about you or anything else you want to say to anybody?
Find your joy.
Find your joy, bitches.
Follow your joy. Yeah.
Yeah. Follow your joy. All right. Thank you so much, Maiden, for being here. I look forward to, doing this again.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Okay.
Definitely.
With that said, thank you guys for being here. I hope you enjoyed this comeback for the podcast. I'm not guaranteeing you weekly podcasts. I am still sick with lupus, and I will be. But, like, I am guaranteeing you that I will try my hardest, and I will put one out as soon as I have the spoons again. All right. With that said, we'll talk to you later. Have a great day. Bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while I'm in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed, so why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking, yeah, sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun.